it, so I need to snuff out that flame before it gets a chance. Like, that was never Luke.
That was never Luke?
No. That was never Luke.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was never him. And, like, the interesting thing, too, is, like, when you look back, and, you know, we all have our feelings about the prequel trilogy, but for me, Revenge of the Sith, one of the greatest moments is, you know, Anakin going dark and, like, killing all the Padawans.
Right.
You know, Order 66. 666.
The kids.
When you watch that and then go back and watch, like, the original trilogy in context, you realize just how far gone Darth Vader was at that point. And then Luke's still willing to save him, whereas, yeah, I agree with you. Like, show Kylo doing something so terrible and Luke witnessing it that it pushes him over the edge.
He probably saw him wear those pants. Like, and then the Kylo, that he was like, this kid is going to grow up to be an internet trend. I must end this.
No, Ben Swallow.
It's gonna be hipster
Swallow.
It's called fashion, sweetie. Yeah.
There's one thing though that you guys have to realize: in *The Empire Strikes Back*, before Luke finds out that Darth Vader is his father, he's willing to go to Bespin. He's willing to fight this guy. He's willing to kill him. That was his plan.
Mm-hmm.
It was after he finds out he's his father, then he's like, "Crap, this is complex. This is not just I have to kill the dragon."
And I also think it was partly through with his training too, with Yoda. Like he becomes a different person. He sees things a little bit differently, but he senses the goodness somewhere in there that he wants to save.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, it makes even less sense for me when you're raising a kid essentially, and it's your sister's kid.
Mm-hmm.
That you would suddenly want to turn on him. So
I'm kind of harping back into like old man Skywalker here because. I mean, maybe he's just tired, you know? He's like, you know what? I'm, like, 65. You know, it's time for me to, like, call this quits. I got my Jedi pension, you know? They gypped us. So, and I'm not getting as much as I'm expecting, and he's probably just done. My issue with Old Man Skywalker is the very end of the movie where he was just a hologram.
No, that was, I don't care, that was badass.
Force projection.
That... For me, save that scene.
Really?
I was just like, what? He's that powerful?
I mean, sure. I know, but to me, I was like, I wanted him to be there. I wanted him to fight.
And
like,
you know, that was great. Like, I love the explorations of, like, the power of the Force. Essentially,
yeah.
You know, with Leia
the vague power.
Doing her, like, thing in space.
Look, everyone needs to get over that if you have beef with that scene. She is of that bloodline, she should be force sensitive.
Exactly.
And apparently a lot of it manifests in times of stress or crises.
Yeah.
So it can happen, right? People, let it go.
And they
still a ridiculous scene. I can't, like, it's still hilarious.
Of it didn't look great. But, like, I mean, if you've read, like, any of the novelizations after the original trilogy, a lot of people would know, like, how powerful Leia actually is. Like, she is very force sensitive. She's equal to Luke, except she just does her power slightly differently. But, I think that it was cool exploring what the Force could do.
Mm-hmm.
It was just weirdly presented, in my opinion.
Yeah.
this whole new trilogy has been exploring the Force in different ways. Even The Force Awakens, the stopping the blaster bolt. We're just like, oh, you can do that? And that was it. They opened the door. They're like, yeah, we can do that. And we're just doing everything now.
The writers, yeah, we can.
Yeah, we can do that. What are you going
to do? Like, stopping the blaster bolt, like, it's a logical step from Force choking someone. Like, it's doable. And, like, then going on to stopping many blaster bolts. Okay, sure, you can do that. But, like, there was just, like, the leap to, like, Force projection, or even just Snoke doing his weird Force telepathy.
Oh, don't get me started on Snoke.
It's major leaps where it's, like, it's hard, I think, for people that are really into the lore to really be like, whoa, what? Like,
well, here's the parallel. Luke is training Rey on the Force, and at the same time he's telling the audience, you don't understand the Force. You don't understand what this is about. You think it's about good and bad. You think we can do this, we can't do that. He's saying, you don't own the Force. Like,
you don't own the Force, girl.
Are
you trying to say he needed to add a snap at the end of the sentence?
Well, he's like telling the audience, like, you guys
clap it
out. Like, you guys think you own it, but you know,
when you word it like that, it goes back to like what Shane was saying about this movie just being a way to shit on sort of fans who are too into it or too like
the ones that think they know everything about it.
And you know, I get that, that's cool. But like at the same time too, just do it logically is my whole thing.
Hold on a second. We're talking about logic here, but we're also talking about like a fantasy galactic story.
That's right.
So
Star Wars is fantasy, not sci-fi.
I know.
I've had this argument. Shout out to everyone who's at my games night group because this was a thing. where we had a, what, 20-minute argument of Star Wars and Star Trek and whether they were both sci-fi or not? No. One is fantasy, one sci-fi. But we can continue.
Boom.
Science fantasy.
I know. If you couldn't tell, I was metaphorically clapping that out while I was saying it.
Yeah.
It just needs to be said. Right?
And, like, so let's talk about, like... Go ahead.
How do you feel about it as, like, a science fantasy, though?
There are science... elements? If you're having ships that can fly, and you have warp speed and things like that.
Yes.
But one of the inherent things of science fiction is that it has to be based in sort of plausible science or grounded science that you can see the real world applications of it. I don't know about the Force, because the Force is more essentially
it's a fantasy thing.
Yeah. It's like their version of God and. In Final Fantasy VII, like the life flow or whatever, that sort of thing.
I agree. What about what do they call that bacteria that explains
the midichlorians?
The midichlorians?
I think really though, what I mean by logic is just like in terms of plot and just believability within the scope of that universe. You're setting up parameters, you're world building, so you want to be able to like push it within the reasonable limits of what that world is. And I'm not saying don't have Luke force project, but like you said, Shane, maybe save that for movie number 3 and show us a little bit of stuff in between.
Yeah.
I still believe it's possible. I saw it.
I do too.
It was still within the realm of believability for me. It's just eases into it.
I don't know if I'm remembering this incorrectly, but I thought, I guess, Vader or Anakin and even Luke were supposed to sort of bring balance to the Force and reach new levels that they never did before. So I'm okay with the 30 some odd years after Return of the Jedi that the Force has morphed or people have gotten stronger with it in different ways. It's just I wish that Luke's characterization was more like Yoda's, where he was like, oh, like you all don't understand that you need to embrace the dark as much as you do the light to reach your full potential, and nothing that you know means anything because we've only been rigid in this black or white sort of way of interpreting the Force. And for Yoda to jump in and be like, hey, like that's because that's pretty much what Yoda was in the
way Yoda would say it. Come on,
I can't.
Wait, Anthony, voice guy?
Yeah, <you are. laughs> Like, I wish Luke had more of that in his arc and kind of beating that into Rey and saying, this is the only way you're going to be as powerful as I know you can become is when you stop focusing on trying to find the dark and stop focusing on trying to find the light and live within that shade of gray. But we got none of that.
Here's the thing.
Until Yoda showed up.
Speaking of, like, Rey, though, how do we feel about her character journey?
Useless.
With her like little rock kung fu karate kid situations, I feel like that's most of what I saw Rey do.
There's also her and Luke being total assholes to their neighbors. Just
there's
like
that, yeah.
Shit. It's just like, oh, well,
strange,
you're not human.
The strange frog nuns.
were they frog nuns
Friends.
Or were they penguin? Oh, no, the other ones were penguins.
Yeah,
they were more for frog nuns.
And that was all for comedic effect too. So they try a little hard with that. But Rey's character, my goodness, there was no training.
You were just whelmed, were you?
I wasn't just whelmed. I was disappointed. I didn't like that this character is just, she's developed already. They're like, you know what, you thought she had more to go in Force Awakens? Nope, she's developed already.
But she's not, like, this is the thing, she's developed in the sense of, okay, you're, like, already a Jedi, but let's underdevelop you when it comes to your relationships with the people around you. Like, this movie happens a week after The Force Awakens, and somehow she's sympathetic to Kylo Ren, even though he murdered the only father figure that she kind of attached herself to.
And as we said,
this
entire story takes place over the course of just a few hours.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The
Last Jedi is maybe 36 hours?
Yeah.
48
maybe.
At most.
And
you're really thinking, like you just said about this, she just watched him viciously murder Han Solo.
His dad.
Right.
Yeah.
Blow up a planet
but
with
like,
Death Star 3.
Her
best friend.
Right.
But he looks good with his shirt off. And that's
why
it's okay.
She had a lightsaber duel where she was willing to murder him when she knew of the relationship between him and Han. And all of a sudden, I feel like I can save him.
But it's just like...
there's that weird thing when they were doing the Force Bond and
the Force Bond.
Certain fans.
Were they touching nipples?
Certain fans, I won't say all of them, but like mostly like the kind of like Tumblr fans who just like ship everything that they see. They're like, oh my god, Reylo is a thing, and it's like, no, it's not. Like Lord Voldemort and like Harry Potter, they had a bond with his scar and with him being like, you know, part Horcrux. That was not considered sexual at all. If it is, you need help.
But she just snatched James away.
But it's just like, you know, why was that considered such like, why, like when he had his shirt off and like, you know, you could sense like that weird kind of like feeling, uncomfortable feeling she had, like, why was it for people like, oh my god, like look at that sexual tension? And it's like,
well,
I
heard
really
Rian Johnson weird. Put that in to show that she would actually see him in the force projection or whatever,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to just sensing him. Like, oh, okay.
There are
other ways
like,
to do
it,
that.
It
yeah, like, he could be, like, scratching his ass. Like,
or
he
could be, like,
about
to kill somebody. And she's like, don't put your lightsaber in your face.
Like,
it's like, you know, like.
Are we still talking about the lightsaber?
Yes.
The lightsaber.
Yes.
Regardless of, like, if she could see him or not, I think that was moot. Like, it's just about them having a connection. But at the end of the day, that connection makes no sense. Like, I can understand maybe Kylo Ren is interested in her because she's powerful and he wants to corrupt her. She does a shitty job at doing it. But, like, Rey having any investment into trying to save him,
mm-hmm.
I couldn't buy that at all. Mm-hmm. And it was, like, for me, it felt very Disney-fied. Like, I just saw it
it's
as
very, like, most
Disney
forgiving
princess
person ever.
Trying to save emo prince over there. Like,
well,
that's
I mean,
what I saw
well,
it as.
That, well, that's
it's
why
very,
I like the hard turn that he kind of made after that. Where it's like, oh, you don't want to be lovers with me? Let's just burn everything to hell. And then,
it's like extreme emo reaction.
It's
like
forever,
take
like,
him seriously.
It's like Forever 21 meets Hot Topic. And it's just like, I can see
you.
And
you're
like,
no, you can't.
You can only save me if you want to do it my way.
Oh, man.
Let me
yeah.
offer this question to the crew then. You were just talking about Luke wanting to save the most terrible dictator villain in
dictator.
Star Wars. Right? Darth Vader was a terrible person. Luke wants to save him. Kylo's a terrible person. Reylo wants to save him. Or Rey wants to save him. Why are we looking at them differently?
There's more time
because
to let
with,
those things digest
yeah,
and
with,
marinate.
With Luke, it was finding out that was his father. Like, I think that's what really got... And because, you know, he heard partial stories from Ben and from Yoda about who his dad was. So I think he understood that his dad was once a good person that became corrupted. So he wants to save him. Whereas, literally, within the span of a week... You know, Rey has to see Kylo kill his father, who to her was a father figure, like someone she actually had a connection to, brutally murder him, kill a whole bunch of people with, yeah, his Death Star Part 3, and then also almost kill her best friend. In a week, you're telling me you can turn around those emotions and suddenly want to
I couldn't turn that around in 5 years.
Yeah, like that's like, that's
I'm in my
30s,
and I couldn't reconcile that in a year,
let alone
a week.
Yeah.
Like,
we let things fester as three-year-olds.
And that, to me, is just a testament to terrible writing. Like,
yeah.
If you understand characterization, if you understand human emotion, you have to give Rey some fallacies. Like, she has to be human.
Yeah.
So I would much understand her wanting to kill Kylo...
Mm-hmm.
And revenge, as
mm-hmm.
opposed to her, oh my god, I need to save him.
It's a really unhealthy thought process to just, like, keep reinforcing the kids. It's like, hey, you can save all those assholes in school and get together, and then they cheat on you, and they break up with you, but they're still good on the inside, so you
should
get back
together.
Yeah,
man, this is not the magic school bus, you know,
yeah.
This is Star Wars, for God's sake.
Kylo!
And another thing that I wanted to bring with you guys, because we were talking about the physics and the sciencey science parts of this whole movie, the light speed, like how using the light speed as a weapon, it just ruins everything.
No,
also,
I thought
that was badass.
I thought that was the
was
best thing. Like and
surprise!
Even, and even the whole silence afterwards,
yes.
I think
like,
that was one of Rian Johnson's best decisions, because that was one of the best scenes in the movie for me. I will hate on a lot of things in this movie, but that was amazing.
That's
yeah?
Amazing.
I'm on the fence. Like, I love the visual aspect. Like, from, like, a visual appreciator of movies, like, that was beautiful. Like, it was so well done. Even just the idea of using the silence, like, that was incredibly good filmmaking. But I definitely think it does kind of undermine everything before, because it's like, you're telling me nobody thought of this.
It's expensive
before.
To do.
Nobody thought of this.
Like, it's that would be my only thing, it does kind of undermine how, like, why didn't they just warp light speed into the Death Star? Like, you know, like.
Because it's a kamikaze mission?
I know. It's an. I would imagine in their universe, light speed is very expensive to create.